got a lot of questions about supplements and which ones I take and why. So I'm going over everything. I got them lined up right here. We'll go over the brands and the doses and the rationale and the evidence and everything, and which ones apply to you or not. Everything I take are essential nutrients. They're widely available. I don't sell any supplements. I don't promote any supplements. I don't promote these brands. I don't have a deal, nothing like that. First supplement I take is a vitamin D. You can get vitamin D from basically four sources. It's naturally present in some foods. Some foods are fortified with vitamin D, so it's added to it artificially. You can get it from sunlight. Your body will produce vitamin D when you're exposed, when the skin is exposed to sunlight. And then the fourth source is a supplement. So foods that are naturally rich in vitamin D are things like fatty fish, beef liver, eggs. Those are some examples. Mushrooms can have some vitamin D if they're exposed to ultraviolet light. But it's a different form. It's mainly vitamin D2. It might be a little less potent, a little less active than vitamin D3. So I personally wouldn't rely on vitamin D2 exclusively for my vitamin D needs. And then foods that are fortified with vitamin D, orange juice, milk, both cow milk and plant milks are often fortified. And some breakfast cereals also have vitamin D added to it. All of those foods I listed are not staples of my diet. I don't have them regularly enough to be confident that I'm getting vitamin D every day. So we're left with sunlight and supplements. In the summer, I probably get enough, but during the winter, I live in the Northern Hemisphere. I'm not confident that I'm getting enough sunlight during the winter on a regular basis to get all the vitamin D that I need. And so I just take the supplement daily and I take it throughout the year. It's easy. Take it one pill a day. This is 1,000 international units. We're going to talk about doses in a second. So for people out there who consume some or many of those foods on a regular basis, you might not need it. Or if you are exposed to sunlight throughout the year, if you live closer to the equator, if you live in the more tropical area or something like that, maybe you're getting plenty from sunlight indirectly and you don't need a supplement. Not everybody does. So why do I take 1,000 international units? The RDA is 600 international units a day. The recommended upper limits is 4,000. So 1,000, 2,000 covers daily needs. And the strongest studies that we have showing any benefit, that's usually the dose that they use. I know there's a lot of hoopla and a lot of ideas out there on the internet about taking much higher dosages, 10,000 international units, 50,000 international units. I've seen no compelling evidence that that provides a benefit. People sometimes point to studies where individuals with higher vitamin D levels in their blood are healthier by different metrics, but that doesn't mean that it's the vitamin D itself providing the benefit. There's many different ways that someone can have a higher level of vitamin D. Obesity, a lot of body fat, lowers vitamin D levels because it sequesters vitamin D into the fat. Also, people who just don't lead a very active lifestyle, or people who happen to be sick and indoors all the time, people living in retirement homes, people who have sort of chronic or terminal illnesses, often low levels of vitamin D will correlate with those populations. So there's a lot of issues interpreting those studies. Bottom line is the evidence that I've seen points to 1,000, 2,000 international units a day, that range, covering our needs and providing all the benefits that are documented. I do make sure that it's a D3 supplement, not D2, for the reasons that we already covered. And these are 1,000 international units per pill, and I take one a day. And this costs about €3, which is about $3, like $4, something like that, for a bottle, and it's good for like 4 months. Also, I don't take vitamin K2. I know it's a popular idea to take K2 with vitamin D, and the idea is that vitamin D increases absorption of calcium in the intestine, which it does, but then the vitamin K2 is supposed to direct that calcium away from the arteries and towards the bone. For heart health, there's a number of studies that have tested giving people vitamin K2. It doesn't really affect risk of heart attack or something like that that's measurable and relevant. And that actually makes sense because calcification is not the problem when it comes to heart disease. It's a consequence of heart disease. So simply keeping the calcium out of the arteries doesn't necessarily provide a benefit. And then for bone health, there are some results suggesting a benefit of K2 supplementation. So that's more evidence-based, although it's usually pretty specific populations. Postmenopausal women, the risk of osteoporosis is higher there. So sometimes in those populations, you see a lower risk of fractures, for example, with K2 supplementation. But for a general population, it is much harder to make an evidence-based argument. So I just haven't seen evidence to back up myself taking it, but your case might be different. So I don't take K2. I'm open to changing my mind if the evidence changes. So that's vitamin D. The next supplement I take is iodine. Same similar logic. So natural sources of iodine are things like fish, seafood, seaweed, milk, and salt are relevant sources of iodine in the Western diet. And those are not staples of my diet. I do eat some of those sometimes, but not on a daily basis or anything like that. So I supplement also from HSN, and it's 150 micrograms taken once daily, which is the RDA. I know some people don't like to supplement because they feel it's unnatural. They prefer to get all of their nutrients from a food or something that they feel is more natural. To each their own, it works getting it from, if you eat fish or if you eat seafood or if you eat seaweed, as long as you're getting enough of the nutrient. Personally, I pay very little attention to whether something is natural or unnatural. If it gives me the results that I want and if it's convenient, and I use it, I take advantage of it. But yeah, there's room for many different approaches. Oh, and this is also about 3 years a bottle and also lasts for about 4 months, same as the other one. Next thing I take is a B12, and this I just take once a week. Again, very similar logic. Natural sources of B12 are animal products like meat and fish. You can also get it from fortified foods. So plant milks often fortify with B12. Breakfast cereals, again, nutritional yeast contains B12 added as well. I don't have any of those foods on a regular basis. Again, you can do that. That's a perfectly viable approach. To me, it's more of a hassle to worry, did I have nutritional yeast today and enough of it, and to have all that, it's easier to just take a B12 once a week, and it's been shown many times that it's perfectly effective, and you get all you need. The brand that I have is this Now 1000 micrograms, and I take two of these once a week, so 2000 micrograms, and this is the cheapest out of the four. This costs about 10 euros for the bottle, and it lasts about a year, so it's negligible. Oh, and people ask about the type of B12, methylcobalamin versus cyanocobalamin. For most people, I don't think it really matters. They both work. There's some evidence suggesting kidney issues with cyanocobalamin. I don't think it's very strong evidence. And for healthy individuals, I doubt it matters. But because I have a family history of kidney conditions and because they're both available, so it really doesn't matter. You can pick which one you buy. I try to buy methylcobalamin. And then the last supplement I take is a long chain omega-3, preformed omega-3s, DHA, EPA. And this one is, the other three are essential nutrients. This one is called a conditionally essential nutrient because there's some debate about whether you convert enough when you get the short omega-3s from walnuts, for example. Does your body elongate enough and make enough of these? There's a whole debate and a whole literature on it. I just supplement with the preformed and play it safe. And DHA and EPA, kind of similar to iodine, is present in fish, seafood, seaweed. So people who have those foods regularly in their diet don't need to supplement. Now with these, the EPA, DHA supplements, there's a massive variation from brand to brand in the doses and the composition and which fatty acid it contains or not. So this is the one I get, this Healthy World algae oil. I believe there's less of an issue for heavy metal contamination with algae, but fish oil definitely works in terms of getting EPA, DHA, no question about that. This one contains both EPA and DHA, which not all do. Sometimes they have no EPA or a very small amount. 600 milligrams of DHA and 300 milligrams of EPA per daily dose, which is actually 2 pills. So that's what I take daily. And this one is the most expensive, but still it costs 20 euros for a bottle and it lasts for about 2 months. That's it. Those are the supplements I take. I don't take any of these popular longevity supplements, the NMN and the rapamycin and the metformin. I've looked at the evidence on those. I don't find it compelling at all that there's a longevity benefit or much of a health benefit at all. I think there's a lot of hype around those, but we covered the evidence on those supplements on a recent video. So I'll link that right here for you guys to check it out. And I'll see you in there.